Manifesto, a published declaration of intent, views, or motives of an individual author or a group. The AltWoke Manifesto opens on a negative note, but why does it begin that way? What sense does it make to deploy a hashtag that's opposed to another hashtag, or hashtags altogether, for that matter? What even is AltWoke? To answer any of these questions, we should first clarify a few things. As a collective, Anon was an accident. We never thought of ourselves as a formal organization. The manifesto was never supposed to be attributed to any entity, and it was never meant to be released at the time that it was. The AltWoke Manifesto wasn't technically written so much as it was compiled from conversations among friends that took place in a secret Facebook group that we made after the 2016 election. That group is no longer active, but it still exists as an archive and is sometimes a fertile wellspring for current work. There's no term more ubiquitous, obnoxious, and self-serving in our current lexicon as woke. Woke is safety pin politics, masturbatory symbolism, and virtue signaling of a deflated left insulated by algorithms, filter bubbles, and browser extensions that replace pictures of Donald Trump with Pinterest recipes. Woke is a misnomer. It's actually asleep and myopic. Woke is the easy button. It combats injustice by sharing videos of police brutality to an echo of outrage. Woke is bereft of irony. It shares HuffPo articles about gentrification from condos in Flatbush and Oakland. Let's start with the question of what even is alt-woke. It's difficult to definitively categorize it to hashtag alt-woke in any positive terms, even for its authors. So it would be probably helpful to first understand what woke is before we define alt-woke. There were conversations that never made it into the manifesto, such as this. Access is still only for these fucking crackers. Ain't no niggas on the left. It's still just hipsterdom. Whoever can fit in. Niggas never fit in because we're too dedicated to making up for lost time hustling. The left is just a disguise for banal, white idea making and fresh to farm. It only seeks to add depth to whiteness. Whiteness eating away at in trendier ways. White kids get to be activist tourists so they can take selfies with brown people they're going on a mission trip with. Things are bad for brown people, and it needs some white people to solve the problem. White savior complex, which does not seriously question the forms of life and power, help produce structural oppression. This is alt-woke reclaiming the original version and meaning of woke.
We just want to be. sipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping. I'm from a hood of broken dreams. Shots firing, yellow tape on the scene. The spookiest Halloween. Go to school, what do you mean? When your mama a fiend, but your little sister a queen. And the fridge so empty, it's hurting your self-esteem. Not to get out on that corner and get it by any means. How to judge, going judges when this is all that we seen. This is all that we know, eviction know that the dough. So we pray like, we gon' get to eat one day. I promise we gon' beat them streets one day. Running around, living reckless, knowing we gon' live at peace one day. I'm thinking, should I get to sleep someday? Cause I've been up all night, chasing this cake to feed my mama and them. Summertime, you hear them sirens again. They said that boy won't make it. You hear them screams? Mama crying again. We had to kill and get it violent in stem. We try and live. My young boy, she was supposed to go to the league. Started popping on them P's, running around with the fleas. All them A's and them B's start to turn into C's. Go from crossing niggas over into running from D's. For you know it, cops pointing at you, telling you freeze. And you can't afford a lawyer, so they telling you plead. Man, this shit worse than cancer, like a fucking disease. Living a nightmare, they telling his dream. Look what they did to Martin Luther. Bullet hole and our kings, and they wonder why we never believe, and they wonder why we never will leave. Nigga, we poor. Young niggas worn about that corner store, but the chinks on that, and you claiming that's your block, who you think on that? Quicksand in the hood and we gonna sink on that. You should think on that.
Theory is no exception to this. Woke is alchemy. It transmutes oppressed identities into advertising campaigns, trend reports, and new demographics to market towards. Woke is poptimistic. It believes Jaden Smith becoming the face of Louis Vuitton is enough to qualify as a win for progress. Woke is content with the status quo. It would be perfectly content if another economic collapse happened tomorrow, just as long as those who rigged it were sufficiently intersectional. We begin our biological development as a small cluster of cells that ultimately differentiate to form our skin, organs, and trillions of other organ systems that make up our bodies. What starts out as a pluripotent handful of cells grows, and as they expand through space, their uniform landscape changes, and these cells differentiate from one another. We'd like to posit that this process, referred to as morphogenesis, should be used as a way of informing how we see ourselves, a mass with an array of potential responses. The potential to respond is unlocked or activated by the environment into which it extends and how it moves through space and time. The environment or medium in which a body exists transmits signals back to the body, forming a sort of conversation, a mutual exchange of information between entities. Cells make signals by accepting a molecule and undergoing a conformational change. For the cell, signals, language, the expression of an inner free will, is automated, determined by chemical reactions and the laws of physics. The idea of hypostition, coined by Walker Stoltz, is one which differs from, but is also the end result of CCRU's notion of hyperstition. While hyper implies something transcendental, something that both goes above and over to a virtual point, but also exists in 3D space, hypo implies something imminent, below or under. Hypostition then refers to that which bubbles below and lies in contrast with hyperstition, the ideas, sometimes even exaggerations, that one interjects into myths that lie on the surface. Hypostition, then, is that which digs beneath all that we know and dredges up that which fertilizes the soil on which we stand. It is a destructive force that also uncovers hidden potentials. This is not to say that this act of uncovering is illuminating an essential truth. This way of thinking would fail to escape a binary divide, and our model would be subjected to a hell that lies between notions of truth and falsehood through this uncovering, an act of revelation. The process of summoning hypostition, beckoning forth what is latent between language and semiotics, is not that fantastic at all. It is through the idea of play as an activity that we may begin to uncover that which is concealed beneath the strata of unconscious understanding. What we find is the substrata of unconscious understanding, the uncanny knowledge without knowing. Some may preemptively object to popularizing the idea of play or focusing on it as a process on the grounds that play lacks seriousness or is nonsensical. Yet, such critiques rest on a misconception of what games are and what they have the potential to be. Games are simply simulations or virtual possibilities carved out and then presented to us that strengthen the capacity for imaginative and strategic forms of thinking. Take video games, for example. Various kinds of game systems exist. Different controllers and consoles sometimes take on different forms in terms of functionality. A PlayStation has a console that differs in terms of functionality opposed to a Nintendo Wii, and that these differences in hardware alter the way players interact with the virtual games and engage in similar but distinct forms of discovery. All consoles highlight the limited ways in which we perceive bodies as they navigate through space. Regardless of whether a console's controller possesses a joystick or a keypad, all video games move characters in terms of direction, such as up, down, horizontally. This gives credence to how we perceive the world as sensory beings. Even on imaginary planets and in the fantastic worlds we create, there are still givens, though even those givens refer to our perception and not necessarily a central truth, as the true nature of space and time is thought to differ from that of our cognitive ability to grasp it. The fact that we cannot begin to develop a video game universe outside of space and time, even with the infinite potential of virtual programming, vindicates the Kantian categories. Games can accurately mimic our limited perception due to material changes in historic events. Old video games, such as Duck Hunt or the first Mario games, were limited in range in terms of character movement. These kinds of games possess limited movement due to limitations in terms of technological capacity, and this revisits us again later on, but instead as a stylistic, intentionally selected aesthetic choice. The ghosts of the past occupy our temporal now, and traces of these specters can still be felt. The differences among video game systems should not be overlooked. They are important as they highlight where our perceptions, and here we mean perception in terms of understanding, where they can be in fact altered or modified. Much like the ways in which a cell with the potential to become one of many specialized kinds of cells is set down a path towards a differentiated form by signals it receives from a given environment, we reveal the numerous potentials we possess as game players when we play a game within an arcade versus when we play a private console at home versus when we engage with a video game made for the computer. This process of understanding both our environments and ourselves in terms of play does not have to be limited to what is traditionally thought of as a game. We can also play linguistic games. Language is not just communication, but discovery. When people converse with one another, they are engaging in a form of play, a form of dialogue. My argument is that these forms of linguistic play can reveal or elucidate truths and uncover or reveal them to others. In the political realm, subjects are formed based on conceptual ideas of historical events and valuations that are formulated in the minds of others that become inscribed upon our flesh and take form as visual representations. The underprivileged term within a binary is set up in relation to a privileged one in an arrangement that can only lead to antagonism, as the subject upon which the subordinate term is placed must wear it and the negative valuations that accompany it. Life for those upon which the privileged term is hung is one that is more prone to paranoia in that they must constantly defend a position of power that is based on notions that are transparent and thin, easily outdated by the passage of time, while they are left looking backwards into a pre-selected narrative that organizes that which has already occurred. Breaking these forms of binary servitude must be broken if the concept of political liberation, and here I mean liberation from politics as we know it at all, is to be realized. Other political subjects have historically altered and played with language to reveal and uncover a potential truth. Historically, language among queer gay, and lesbian identities has been altered and new forms interjected to suit a wide array of gender presentations. Terms such as soft butch, femme, and interjecting they into language as another pronoun that one can identify with are examples. Such games expand from more than two ideas of gender representation. Linguistic exploration uncovers the pre-existing idea that the binary structure with its rigid archetypes was inadequate to begin with, that numerous possibilities for gender expression already exist. When communities interject this kind of language into the world, they play with what Bifo Berardi calls futurability, or a layer of possibility that may or may not develop into actuality. Beyond that, such ideas set up the possibility for a new not yet here, something which the subject who occupies the privileged term must respond to, even if unknowingly. Those who occupy the term over the othered subject will paradoxically make concessions to the present in order to maintain a conception of time that insists on a narrative which glorifies the past. Thus, increasing the possibility that a previously less probable not yet here may appear can be seen as a tactical strategy for attenuation. Power in the hegemonic sense inserts automated selections into the realm of the social. To attempt and insert a new possibility into hegemonic narratives will require energy, as energy is required to overcome resistance. And here I'm referring to both energy and work in the scientific sense. Such energy has the potency to actualize possibilities. We also want to steer clear of generating myths, as myths function as normative frameworks, often too rigid and inflexible to handle the dynamic nature of that which is not yet. A myth is a narrative telling of how symbolic snapshots of the past are interlinked. We should instead combat other already existing tales with a dynamic notion. Games, in this case, could be seen as a possible alternative in attempt to reconceptualize what it means to interject a dynamic toolbox in place of the notion of narratives. In Homo Ludens, a study of the play element in culture, Johann Huizinga claims that within the notion of play, there is something, quote, which transcends the immediate needs of life and imparts meaning to the action. If we call the active principle that makes up the essence of play instinct, we explain nothing. If we call it mind or will, we say too much. However, we may regard it, the very fact that play has a meaning implies a non-materialistic quality in the nature of the thing itself. And it is these non-material qualities, this gray space, that we should open up and explore.
Firms, nations, masses, these are the creatures of modern political economics. The firm, the company, Facebook, Google, Netflix, Uber, Bayer, Monsanto, Unilever, these are the beasts in the menagerie of capitalism. They exist in distinction to humans, people over profits. Their legal classification as persons arouses in us a revulsion of taboo, as if something inhuman or alien has entered our community, a biological impurity, a thing masquerading as a human. The struggle of capitalism is between beings, the human being and the corporate being. But what is the firm? Why does it exist as a ubiquitous organizational mode of capitalism? What is its facticity? In 1937, economist Ronald Coase asked how the firm structure arises out of the free market. Why is there any organization rather than an open market of transactions? Coase's answer was that contracting capital and labor for long terms avoids the costs of searching through a market for factors of production every time production requires an input. The cost of information delimits the boundaries between firms. In the epistemic field of prices, firms contain many accountable elements, but only one surface of knowledge. All of the services a person might provide cohere into the employment contract. All of the services of a machine are internalized by purchasing it. Firms structure their composition on the marginal costs of coordinating labor and capital. The firm is an epistemic economic fiction, which is a creature of the media ecology of a paradigmatic info regime. In this graph, we plot the relation between the marginal product of a contractable service and the cost of using the market to find it. We take the cost of information to be a certain level, the average cost of making transactions in general within the market. Coase's theorem suggests a corresponding threshold of product, which delimits the point at which a firm would create a long-term contract of ownership or employment, or where it would choose to outsource in a one-time contract, finding it within the market. Information technology lowers the costs of transactions. We would notice that a reduction in the general cost of making transactions will shift this threshold inward. Declining costs of information decompose the epistemological modality of hiring employees and purchasing capital. Cheap information allows the market to dissolve the categories of employee and capital into its constituent services. Employees become the sum of their parts, and those parts can be individually traded in the market. We shift away from the employment labor modality within the putrescent spaces of total information platforms to individually traded packets of labor time contracted at the individual level. The employment paradigm dissolves into automated contracts on platforms, rapid, faceless, and flexible. This cascading attenuation of productive factors follows from what commentators are calling the fourth industrial revolution. Knowledge and capitalism are intertwined. Production benefits from knowledge. Total surveillance is not a political possibility, but an economic inevitability. What used to be a factory is now a platform for machines, permeated by networks. The factory as an object on which Marx's political economy so vitally relies has disintegrated into particles of capital. That is why we call it a network analytic, because of its epistemological effect of turning fields and surfaces of knowledge into fungible and discrete pieces of information. Franco Bifo Berardi says, quote, "Info labor is innately precarious for the simple reason that the allocation of work time can be disconnected from the individual and legal person of the worker. An ocean of valorizing cells convened in a cellular way and recombined by the subjectivity of capital. Capital no longer recruits people, but buys packets of time. Everything which is monolithic reduces to sand with the application of knowledge as a solvent exposing flat surfaces to additional dimensions. Like Marx said, all that is solid melts into air." This is the model of labor and capital sourcing startups. Uber, Postmates, TaskRabbit, Fiverr, WeWork, and Amazon. None of these platforms actually fulfill the end function. Uber doesn't drive you anywhere. Uber automates the task of contracting labor in the market. Postmates, a delivery app, has no delivery employees. It only has users. They have no offices where they start their day, no company shops to fix their cars or bicycles, no common spaces to come together as employees to discuss and to organize. Information technology has outsourced their services beyond the limit of the firm. Fiverr, an online marketplace, supplies just about anything you can want for around $5. Someone will make a logo for your company. Someone will do your taxes. There are even people out there who will write you love letters, and good ones. Many of the suppliers of these services are from the third world, places like Nigeria and India, with high levels of technical education but no market for jobs. By selling their info labor to the first world for only $5, they can make pretty decent money. There is something threatening about this to the first world. Taxi cab drivers riot against Uber drivers in France. The salary and benefits of an academy-trained graphic designer are undercut on Fiverr by a laborer in India who taught herself using pirated software and YouTube tutorials funded by advertising that sold tchotchkes and underwear subscriptions to first worlders. The first world gets cucked. Smart contracts and the app do not pay, modify not factory work, but the cushy jobs of upper middle class Westerners, bankers and lawyers. The next phase of automation is not in primary production, but in management and info labor, liquidating the role of the global middle class within the supply chain. Management workers with so-called good jobs are sloughed as employees and rehired as independent contractors. The 2001 financial crisis conducted such a shift by dispensing with salaried middle management and rehiring labor in retail and food services. The worst fears of the white Western liberal come true. Everyone is reduced to proletarian status. This is the black pessimism of alt-woke, that we should look down for our futurities, not up. The physical territory of offices dissolve into the abstracted network maps of WeWorks, who own not buildings, but space. Temp jobs with no benefits are made free and easy by the wonders of capitalism. This is insurrectionary in a sort of way. You have to laugh at the banker who, finding his fortune gone, throws himself out of a window. It sort of does the job for you. Or the middle-class family who can no longer afford their McMansion, globally reduced to the same simmering worldwide poverty which had always existed. We had grown fat for so long, thinking this would go on forever. We did not heed the lessons of ecology. The dialectical circuit has run its course through the modalities of production media from a thesis of landless serfdom, antithesis of belonging, employee, citizen, to the synthesis of deterritorialized gigged worker. A Foucauldian attenuation of power utilizes the surveillance state to break the threatening body of the worker into harmless cells. Meanwhile, this disciplinary apparatus reduces its own presence in present space and present time, requiring fewer functionaries to carry out its authority. It becomes both singular and untouchable, diffuse in time and space, ambient. Platform capitalism points towards neo-feudalism, a philosophy which is taken seriously and embraced by right accelerationists and corporate rule patchwork models. This is the reaction of the future. Capital fragments into networks of microfinance. Nothing is owned, everything is rented. The analytic which we are now applying to firms also applies to every interaction we have in society. In the first row, we start with the modern modality of late capitalism, and then we introduce its solvent technology and find its result. The first column presents our mass-based media ecology creature. The technology of the second column is a sort of market which allows users to access the components of the first column without taking the whole package. The third column is the new modality. Even things we might not consider as masses, because they are not composed of individuals, such as gender and monogamy, are composed of behaviors and actions which can be liquidated into those individual parts. The social contract of monogamy disintegrates into a series of encounters, dinner, intimacy, sex, freed of commitment to a single person in a quasi-political compact. The future pretends a global information system in which everyone is equal. Production, existing everywhere, becomes ambient, allowing no power differentials. Mankind is both removed from production and homogenized in relation to the technicum. Planetary achieves worldhood through the nomadic knowledge machine of capital. Man is freed from his material constraints. Humanity achieves spiritual transcendence from its bodily creatureliness. No more firms, nationalities, or genders. Automated translation unites mankind over creaturely distinctions. All human functions reduced to the pressing of buttons. There is the potential for a global jail whose power is more intimate than we could imagine. There is also the potential for a renewed internationalism and socialist interventions. With the middle class bourgeoisie ablated by the forces of production, Workers are united around the globe, and the 20th century consumer good bric-a-brac of consumer capitalism no longer commands political acquiescence. Finally, the very platforms which dissolved the privilege of the first world are the informational creatures which allow the global proletariat to coordinate and control the market, to siphon surplus value from productive processes. Hack the surveillance state and turn it against capitalism. Communism is revealed not as a dead fetish, but a revived monster, slouching towards Bethlehem to be born with a gaze as blank and pitiless as the sun. Two interventions present themselves. First, to accelerate this process into a state of famine-instigated warfare, to collect the machinic rents of dissociating spirit from capital. Two, to articulate state policies regulating new modalities of firms and work in ways that maintain the positive rights of individuals, citizens, and humans. Socialism, stuck for so long in mass thinkings, must update to the world of platforms and disillusion.
You can put the lights up.
Thanks.
Hi, thanks so much.
Yeah, it's a little quiet.
It's just a quick question about your process of writing the text. And has it been a collective process, or how did you come to this final, these final pieces that you read out today?
Oh, today it's, we split it into threes, I guess. So the one member that isn't here but will be here for the other days, he sent something, and then I put something together, and then Joe did something. But we kind of read each other's texts and stuff like that. Pieces like the manifesto, other ones, it depends. Sometimes it's two of us, sometimes it's all of us.
Yeah, so these pieces that we read are more or less individually made. But the pieces that we publish, we refer to it as the hive mind.
Yeah.
Like, we all put stuff in a Google Drive, and it gets all mixed together, and we copy and paste, and we end up with a document whose authorship is kind of...
ambiguous.
Kind of unknown. Yeah, yeah. Totally ambiguous. And it's so funny, like, yeah. I'll be at home, and I'll be reading something, and be like, oh my god, I have to tell you guys about it. And then that idea will come up in casual conversation in such a way where we're like... We're somehow thinking the same thing across, you know, time and space through the internet, which we're very proud of because it fits into our theory so much.
Yeah. And there are other people that, you know, aren't here but have definitely contributed as well, like conversations. And that's what we were trying to bring up in the first section, is that a lot of it is collected from, like, what other people have said, and they're, like, tangentially members, you know, or just as members as much as anyone else. We don't really... like this sort of structure that happens, and that's part of why we didn't really want to do the non-anonymous thing, but, you know, whatever.
The form or format of this lecture could perhaps be described as overloaded. Why?
Overwounded? What do you mean?
There's not enough time to pay attention to everything.
Well, there's a lot of stuff we have to talk about in order to talk about the entire world that needs to be overturned.
That's kind of also the media ecology that we're confronting too, is that when you're going through your social media feed, when you're looking on the internet, you are sort of overwhelmed. And you gloss over things, and you kind of see the image or you see the chart, and you get more of an effective feeling from it, and then it progresses to the next idea. So the overloading is intentional, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, of course. And also, it's just, I think when we started the project, it was something talking about, you know, the left and things like that. Parts in the first section are from the manifesto, and it was like, you know, starts off with categories of the left's failures. After that, we started trying to explain what the quote-unquote right was to other people. And what we soon realize in trying to explain those things to people is that we had to then explain the counter argument, or like what the popular argument is. So for instance, to explain things about something like human biodiversity, which is just crackpot science, you have to explain to people what actual biology is. But then you elucidate that people don't know what actual biology is, right? So then we kept going backwards to realizing that literally we need to overturn a lot of things that people know. So, yeah, sorry. I guess it's just more of a process that has to happen. And with AltWoke, it has to be more than one encounter and meeting with the information.
Yeah, because things get so bogged down, right? Like with what you're saying about people who believe in biological diversity, and you're like, wait, I have to explain to you that, like, all these really basic things, and then you start entering their field more and more, and they kind of draw you in. And I think that the left often hobbles itself with trying to educate people from first principles rather than moving into new aesthetic dimensions of their own creation.
And to also just quickly explain, I guess, the three parts in a sentence or so. The first part was supposed to be a bit of an overview of things that we've written, an introduction. The second part was talking about, I guess, since I, you know, more so authored it, how to channel the frustration I was feeling when talking to others and having these conversations where you have to end up going backwards and talking about so much. Not with them, but with, you know, the world as a whole. And that's why I started to try and posit the idea of playing as opposed to like myths or narratives, that narratives as a structure, like just if you step back as like a structural component, can wound people, and that they can fall back into patterned forms of recognition and then recitation. And that ultimately can lead to, in extreme cases, extremism and fascism. And then the third is from Joe, and I mean, you could talk if you'd like, but I guess the way I would explain it is the more economic side of things. I mean, we did all start sort of as Marxists meeting in school, so we wanted to talk about both the social whole but have like economic components, and how within this technological sphere that we now have, I guess, where everything is permeated more so by a particular form of technology, that interesting things are happening and businesses are changing and it's changing us.
And so the question is, when you're explaining these economic theories, how do you make them not boring? How do you make them viral, right? You need to translate it into a sort of aesthetic and sort of cultivate that. So throwing as much stuff at the wall as we can in order to try and derive like a poetics out of the tea leaves, right?
I'm sorry, one last thing. Mm-hmm. If you actually notice after a while, we are making the same point sometimes from different, in different ways. So I can speak specifically to what I sort of wrote. The reason why I talked about, say, biology, and then I talk about something like queerness, and I talk about something like language, I'm making the same point three times. It was just in different forms. So we're talking about signaling, basically, as a theme, that there is this reciprocal relationship between ourselves, the environment that we take in, the signals that we take in from the environment, and how those change us and pattern our movements. And pretty much, like, in my mind, I was just saying that in different forms, each and every way, in different ways.
I have this question about, like, it's not sure if it's addressed specifically to you or to like accelerationism in general, but since like accelerationism or like left accelerationism is having this utopian like hegemonic worldview where like we need to develop, we need to find a new future and stuff like that, then my question is, what infrastructures do you think we need to build, or like what do you propose if you are talking about the firm and like its structure and how it's dissolving everything around? And so like what are we to become in order to kind of become a political force?
Yeah, so this is where platforms come in. Platforms kind of replace the firm as a modality. And platforms want to be what's called a monopsony, which is like a monopoly, but for demand. So such that whenever you provide a good or a service, you have to go through this one platform. So like Mark Zuckerberg has a monopsony on photos right now, right? Because he owns Facebook and he owns Instagram. And if you want to share photos, you go through Facebook or you go through Instagram. And so the reason why this happens is because platforms, being immaterial, being based on information, benefit from network effects. You want everything to be on the same network, and the more that everything is on the same network, the more efficient that it is. It kind of defies the old physics of monopolies and why we had to break them up and why they weren't good for consumers. So we're faced with this kind of problem that we have big companies making platforms that benefit from being the only player in town. And so the possibility of reining these in and kind of jumping on top of them is that you thus gain the tools that communism didn't have in the 20th century to direct and control the information of the market. So this requires an intervention. It's not going to happen on its own, because on its own it's going to be a neo-feudal corporate state. But this is where the possibility for a socialist future opens up, right here, is talking about platforms and talking about state interventions to platforms.
And it's interesting that there was this part in this whole thing that I wanted to put in the piece that I had done that I ended up sort of nixing at the end about applying ideas of Kantian notions of beautiful and sublime to internet platforms and just like proliferation of images on the internet, maybe making the argument that there is more of a space now for sublime images. So that's images that can be like horrifying or awe-inspiring, just take you, can captivate you in a certain awe-inspiring but maybe horrifying way. And if we think about the platforms that we're on, the way in which images are proliferated and videos are proliferated can do this. But going back to, I guess, some things that Joe had said and tying it to the rest of the things that I had said in my talk, the point that I wanted to make was that it is the environment that you're in when you're in these social spaces or on these technologies. Everything can be seen as an environment. And that dictates how we will take in and then how we like spit out that information, how we deal with it. So as sort of Joe pointed out, under current things, if nothing is sort of done, I believe that it's going to sort of just go, yeah, towards like neo-feudalism in a way. Only because the platforms in and of themselves still operate in a capitalist mode of production, but it's towards digitization. And that means that we are, they're commodifying your actions, right? And it's in a way that is so nefarious because we don't see it as commodity making in the typical sense. If your clicks are being commodified, if those actions are being commodified, then it's hard for people to really think about it, and they'll just keep paying people in this way. Right? Yeah.
Yeah. Hi, I would like to ask you about this like idea of gamification and what you see, what is actually like liberatory potential of games. If you could maybe kind of like develop a little bit this idea of like algorithmic governance platforms and basically future liberatory potential of that.
Well, yeah, so, well, because I guess this is also tying into like what we were talking about earlier, and that I feel like even though that is like a question dedicated towards me, because I was talking about games, like Joe could probably answer the second half about platforms. But when I was talking about social identification, I don't believe, or what I was trying to highlight is not necessarily that it is something that is just identified to, but that there are binary structures. I guess it's more like Derrida would say, like in terms of linguistics and stuff, we tend to organize in terms of binaries, and one is a privileged term and one isn't. And so the creation of what the subject then identifies as the underprivileged term tends to be created outside of them. So then like if you look at certain things such as maybe the gay movement or whatever in ball culture in the United States, they're playing with and identification that's already been placed on them, and they're trying to twist and do like a, I mean, maybe like a detournement with it, play around with it. They're saying, and part of the reason why something like ball culture is so interesting is that they would do things where they would dress up and have different categories and different, I guess actually games in a sense, where someone would dress as, say, a business executive and then would be called executive realness. And what that in and of itself highlights is that they cannot go out, or these people and those gay men at the time could not go out into the world and just be a business executive because of the nature of their subjectivity, that they have to go into this other space, and then to win, it's to perform what it means to look like and appear as a business person flawlessly. And it's playing with those structures. And so I think the question, in a way, sort of both needs to be turned inside out, but like I want to also build on it, and that I don't think, like, the direction is maybe wrong, that I think for the subjectivities that I'm talking about, they're sort of placed on you, and then what you do with them is sort of playful in order to elucidate the directionality of domination in and of itself.
Right. So when you, this applies to not firm so much as taking binary identities as masses and then devolving them into their constituent performances. And the idea of play comes in as an interrogation of what it means to be a man or a woman, because you're taking out the performances and then using them as a language. Right, so that's kind of a liberatory practice within the analytic that we have. And that's also true for like monogamy. You can also apply it to structures and institutions like newspapers devolving into people sharing articles with each other. You don't have the mass of the newspaper, you have the attenuated particles of everyone contributing within it. And so this kind of frees up these black boxes of masses of identities or institutions into their constituent parts, which now can be articulated in different and playful ways.
Thank you. But if we, I'm quite interested in this whole idea of like platforms and forcing us to behave in certain ways. So when I sort of talk about like algorithmic governance, you know, how do we overcome this? Can like maybe game or play, how kind of like denying this binary identities, how can it help us to fight the sort of governance of platforms or...
Yeah, like, right.
If you see what I mean.
Yeah, so we're trading one socially disciplinary force for another. And we don't know exactly what that means. That's just the question we're presenting. We don't have too many answers with that now. It starts pretty well. It's easier to see when we talk about gender and identity, and it's harder to see when you talk about platforms as business models. It kind of requires more wonkish policy talks. But that's exactly the tension that we're trying to bring out, is that we are trading different social disciplinary mechanisms, and the question is for what and how can we make it more liberatory rather than more more finely totalitarian, right? That is the hazard.
I have two questions. One, the first one is like, don't you think that identifying yourself as alt woke or alt left is like binary in itself?
How so?
Well, because it's clearly it's like putting yourself on one side while putting the alt right or whatever on the other side and trying to identify each of these directions in like quite clear and separated ways.
Well, sure. In other pieces, I guess we talk more about what directionality means, because that's a question that came up to us. But I mean, not necessarily placing yourself, acknowledging that you exist within the binary doesn't necessarily uphold all of the conditions of the binary in and of itself. It's just recognizing that a binary exists. It's what you do when you're in that position. So that's, guess why I was talking about, for say, like queer identities or something like that. They're identifying as that, but it's what they're doing and what they're interjecting in and of itself into the process that's important. We believe that the left as a model, or I guess if we think about it as a structure, has a more of a ability to break up and bleb up forms. So by playing, I guess, the thing that I was talking about in my talk, these type of games, what you're really making happen is making the subject that occupies the privileged term in the binary give up something, whether or not they know it. In order to defend their own position, they'll have to respond to you. And this is how, I guess, it's happened historically, that the right, unintentionally, and I'm just speaking very broadly, although I could get specific if you'd like, has pushed modernity forward.
Yeah, so it is supposed to be a little bit cheeky, right, calling out fellow leftists I think Karim is more into sort of the naming of AltWoke.
Oh, it was supposed to be stupid. It was like, let's make a dumb movement so people will know, like, it's just something silly to say.
Yeah, it's supposed to be playful. Yeah. In an antagonistic way.
Okay. And then I have another question, which is, I think it's obviously, and you guys do too, important to educate and not...
In fairness, I'm sorry. Here.
Uh-huh.
I think it's the mic is like...
Hello.
Hello?
Yeah. Yes, and so... This... Uh-huh. Okay. And so this manifesto is very important, and it's important for you guys to come here and talk about this. And don't you think that there's a global collective sort of shift towards more and more people thinking about these sort of issues and sort of perhaps even acting on them? And don't you think that, this is a question. Do you think that it's important to perhaps accelerate this movement, let's say, to... stimulate it through more aggressive actions, let's say, because you did point out, you did have three steps, right? One of which was also, I don't know.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was wondering, don't you think that perhaps, and also history has shown that that does accelerate if you act on your ideological base with aggressive actions, well-placed aggressive actions, let's say. Hacking the political system or whatever. There's multiple ways, probably, or options. Do you think that that would be a step that you guys would be willing to get behind, let's say, or support?
It depends, I guess, and I say that only because what I was trying to get at today, and I think what we're trying to get at, is a bit of a progression past some of the things that we wrote, as well as talking about it more in depth. I don't want to give out prescriptions anymore to people, only because, for one, the future is something that is not yet here, and so it's hard to say from now what you should do. And that's why I guess I was trying to elucidate in the first place the idea of games and playing, because that's a process, that's not a prescription. Because when you're saying support more extreme, whatever, or support this and support that, I could say, it depends on time, place, who, what. I would need to know the specifics. And maybe tomorrow I would say no. And so instead I wanted to maybe try and get people thinking about a more active and dynamic process. Because whenever you make a narrative, you're doomed to sort of meet yourself later in the worst possible way. I think that people maybe are trying to take up things like this in more extreme versions, but unfortunately, and not to be too Hegelian here, there's a bit of a dialectic happening. No, there's another side of it that is just as ruthless. And unfortunately, they occupy a space that exists within, I guess, the dominant sphere already, so they have all the capital and the backing in the world.
Yeah, I think I've... sort of a two-part answer to that, the first of which is that everything is permitted and everything is critiqued. So it's not like we're saying that the things that other people are doing are wrong. We just sort of want to investigate the ways in which they are effective We want to put forth a theory on how things can be more effective and new lines of intervention. And then the second thing is we are really critical of mass-based leftism. And we participated in a lot of protest movements in New York City. We were in Occupy Wall Street. We were in Black Lives Matter. And those protest movements have this really disillusioning momentum that can't be sustained. It's like we got like 10,000 people down on Wall Street. Like, we broke through the barricades. We were there out in front of the NASDAQ. And then what? Why have masses failed to translate into political power? I think it's because the terrain of politics and the terrain of political economics has changed in a way that needs to be reckoned with. So the modalities, like, so shifting away from firms and moving to platforms and shifting away from employees to gig workers, like, we have 100 years of socialism and progressivism and activism that won us the 8-hour workday, got us the 40-hour work week, it got us workers' comp, it got us regulations on what companies can and cannot do, and we have this huge corpus of law which governs these old forms that are now changing. And the hazard is that now that you have platforms who don't employ employees technically, you don't have any of those packages of rights. So as far as a specific intervention of socialist goals, you need to find a way that people can contribute labor outside of the employment legal paradigm and still have rights and still have human dignity. I think there's kind of a problem there because you don't want to you don't want to reinforce work, because work itself is kind of problematic. The idea that we have to pick a career and be productive in order to survive. And yet you don't, like, there's not a good way of shifting away from work that is a pretty good solution. Like, one way of shifting away from work is to just give citizens equity or give a universal basic income based on, like, the corporate economy, because then you are, like, destroying workers altogether and sort of co-opting them with the interests of corporate capital. So these are the two possible paths. They're both kind of hazardous, but maybe these are the specific sort of answers of policy that you're looking for and that we're trying to think about.
So I just have a quick question, or actually two quick questions. So first and foremost, I don't know, have you heard of Anders Amot? He's a holochain developer.
Yeah.
He talks about the idea of xenogaming.
Yeah, he's
which
really cool.
I would be interested, perhaps, if you have some familiarity with it, maybe expanding upon it, because I think it kind of complement this idea about gamification that you keep hinting at. But I would like maybe if you can explore it a bit further, because I really think his idea, kind of thinking about a Pokemon Go, Pokemon going something towards a post-capitalist future, is maybe a template. But of course, we have to still come down to looking at something logistically. And my second question would be, so you keep talking about these platforms. I mean, there's a multitude of platforms, but can you identify like a concrete platform that you would see maybe that would, where, you know, a large shift of people can decouple from something such as Facebook, move over to, I'm not saying they're the best ones, but something like Discord, something such as Mind, something as Diaspora. I think these would be some channels to obviously consider. Of course, I know some of these channels might have a bit of alt-right, elements to them, not all of them, because I think it's far more of a complex ecosystem, but I would just like to hear if you can speak to any of those types of issues there.
In terms of Anders, I did meet him, I guess, a year ago. And I don't know all the specifics of the holochain technology, so I guess I can't really like answer that fully, other than like, yeah.
But you've seen that video, Hyper Reality?
Yeah.
That's like a bizarre dystopia of this person who's a worker, and she has an AR thing, and she has like points, and you can see it from her perspective, and messages from her boss keep popping in, like, hey, you need to do this thing to get experience, to level up, and it's brightly colored and neon and so crazily dystopian. So the Pokemon Goification of work is both a potential for liberation as well as one for more totalitarianism, you know, which is why we need to have these conversations now, which is why we need to start talking about it as a possibility, so that we can kind of articulate the values that socialists will have moving forward into these futures, which are going to be sort of undeniable, right? It's not that we are going to choose whether or not to have more invasive forms of production or work, but we need to articulate where those rights establish boundaries and categories and classes. And then the second question was about platforms. It's super hard to get away from Facebook, right? There's like a gravity to networks that have a sufficient number of contacts, because the reason why you use the network is because it has a lot of contacts, which is why you don't have like the weight of an inefficient monopoly. To the contrary, it actually gets more efficient. So personally, I think you need to intervene from the top down, and you need to regulate and make rights of users. Like if you made a user a political category, that could be a possible starting point, but it's really hard to get away. Go on.
No, I mean, I can't answer it, I guess, from like the more economic sense, but I guess the way that I see it, the more bottom-up ideas are that social ideas and ideologies get baked into everything that we do, including the platforms that we run. I think just like yesterday or whatever, I was complaining to Joe about the differences that I notice in terms of functionality and how comfortable it makes me feel between, say, something like Instagram, Facebook, and Tumblr. That if you look at something like Instagram, I don't like the feature where it tells you what, if you're friends with somebody, it tells you what that person liked when you see random images in it, that it tells you who out of your friends group follows people, because I think it kind of like opens the door up for other people to be like, you know, hey, why are you following this friend? Same thing with Twitter a little bit, like people have gotten in trouble for just liking something because there's a page on which like it shows the likes that you have. Whereas I guess maybe some other sites, the only one I can think of now is Tumblr. If you have liked something on it and you click it, you can't necessarily just correlate one-to-one the user. Maybe that's just like a very vague example, but there is, it is all dedicated towards value capture and creation under a very specific model under the capitalist mode of production. However, every single person that makes these platforms has ideas about like what they think about these platforms.
Yeah. It's like automated snitching.
So, yeah, yeah.
And that's a super good question, because it's about like what you do with hegemony and how you attack it and how you try and co-opt it. So it's not a question that we can answer, but like a question that needs to be highlighted whenever we move forward.
Thanks. I wanted to ask just a question about maybe at the very end of your speech, you were proposing kind of steps which might give us kind of a hope. And you mentioned regulations, like regulations of a structure, how firm is built. And my question is, to regulate something, you need a kind of a power which could be like the out source or inner power. So either you somehow as somebody who overcomes the platform or whatever entity we would like to regulate, or you have a different sources of inner regulations. And my question is whether what kind of institutions has to be built up to really provide this anonymous, like mass, critical mass, to have kind of impact, to regulate something.
Yeah, you need to devise new levels of institutions, right? You need to create basically global institutions. And we've needed to for a long time because capital has a planetary nature. It's slippery and slimy. We need a new internationalism to sort of rise above the platforms. It's kind of like a nesting egg problem that the proletariat constantly need to create an informational platform that's larger than the informational platform of the capitalist. So we're hoping that maybe the democratization of knowledge and the democratization of productive processes can potentially give us the institution that has that size.
Also, to kind of follow on the previous question, is there, like, do you maybe propose that we need something like an left alternative to fortune or to politically incorrect stuff, or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I know that like in the original AltWoke manifesto, you were referring to the alt-right, and like alt-right has somewhat proved effective in disrupting certain like political debates and being like really trollish, and also I think in some ways playful. So do you maybe think that we need something like 4chan, but again like being able to defend itself from actual 4chan?
Not quite. Only in as much as I think the left as a whole should give up on ideas of making lightning strike twice. And by that, what I mean is, we're talking about 4chan in relation to the alt-right. However, 4chan existed way before that, and it was not really that right of a space, even though there was the same type of like humor on there. The board poll out of which the alt-right helped. It wasn't formed out of there, but where the clickbait Nazis came from, it wasn't that reputable, like way back. Nobody even really went on that board. And actually a lot of what I would assume to be left-leaning people came out of it and started making movements like Lulzsec. I think at the time somebody hacked into Sarah Palin's emails. Someone hacked into like the credit card companies. And I think we sometimes forget like what that was originally. But you have to think then about like we exist with the state and the state has an ideology. And a lot of those 14-year-olds got arrested or threatened with jail time. And after that, especially Occupy kind of killed the mood for a lot of the left. And then I think it just sort of blebbed into nowhere. So I wouldn't quite... Maybe it's not that satisfying of an answer. I don't know what the next platform should be, but it can't be 4chan again, because that mode is done.
Do you want a more serious question or more playful question?
Can we do serious first?
Oh,
and
yeah,
then...
yeah, do serious.
And then we can lighten
serious,
the mood.
Really.
Well, you are usually serious.
Hey, thank you so much for the debate and for the presentation. I just wanted to pick up the conversation that was here before about the games. I'm just quite worried that we are in the 2018 and still the most popular game is Fortnite, for example, and stuff like that. So I'm just thinking, to what extent game as mass medium hasn't been already appropriated in a way which actually gets the medium into kind of deadlock, where actually it can be, you know, evacuated from. So, but that's the one thing that's more of a worry. But the question then is like, what should be a trait of a game which should be properly subversive or emancipatory in terms of narratives, in terms of... It's not necessarily about values. I'm asking more about technical specifications or about the narrative specifications, about the way how the world imagined there and dreamed through that medium is actually presented.
Sure. Yeah, I guess it is hard to say what to do. However, something with like Fortnite and other games that are produced right now, particularly Fortnite's a great example, is sort of indicative in a way of like some of the cultural things I was trying to bring up. One, as I guess I keep saying, like we exist in a world that produces economically in a very particular way. And thus, like in order to adapt with that, because capitalism is also a very adaptive force, we now have like these strange pay for as you go, kind of trick you into paying or trick you into feeling more so like you want to pay games. But also, I have heard with Fortnite that there are some dances that they do in the game that are actually like the nene and stuff like that, that these are like black forms of like dancing, and they don't call it the nene. It's called the Fortnite dance, or it has no name. It's an amorphous no-name dance, but they make money off of it, right? And like people, it's a bit of a historical trend there. So when we talk about like the fantastical elements of and possibilities of games, although I just pointed to one that already exists and I was like, I don't know, I think I would also think of ones that do exist and kind of eliminate for this for the moment the fact that they're produced within the mode of production that they are, because that's just everything. But like games like Final Fantasy, games like, I could say like Final Fantasy, and then I could say Resident Evil. And these are two types of games, and I'm just trying to elucidate that like you could have one that brings out horror in you, that your friends all play together and get scared when you like play it, and that's sort of fun. But you could also have one that's like more fantastical or whatever. Actually, it's like I'm speaking. A good example is with Nintendo and Super Smash Brothers. So people would play it competitively, and Nintendo would not host it, whereas other game companies would, like would have if it was them, because Nintendo thought their ethos was that you shouldn't be playing games competitively. Their whole thing is about friendship and all that stuff. I mean, they eventually sort of folded on it, but it's just this idea that like you can make various different types of games. You don't really have to like limit the possibilities. And like functionally, if you're thinking about that part, it can start with like the number of players you have, start with the connections between the players, and maybe trying to make the connections more of equal value amongst each of them, if that makes sense.
I guess the answer is like, actually none of the games will ever be like forever subversive. It's just like being one step ahead of the capitalist machine to, that sucks in, right?
Yeah, it's
it
just
can, it can never stay that way forever.
Yeah, it's just a it's an empty shell, just like anything. Well, not like anything else, like certain things. Like I think of technology as something more of an empty shell, that it sort of takes on the form of things that we exist and as we see it in the world. And games, like I guess what I was trying to say was, we shouldn't limit ourselves to thinking of them as just like one or two ways of things. Like we can inject a ton of different possibilities, like I said, by changing the number of players that you begin to start with. Like even if you really think about that, and what I was trying to sort of also say is that like when you pick up a controller, I'm talking like about literal games, there's a difference between like how you play, say like an N64 because the joystick is in the center, as opposed to say like something with a control pad, which is different than like if you go into an arcade and like how you interact with that. And if you think narratively about the actual structure of the game, there's a really big difference between like first person shooters and like things that have more narrative forms, that have just one character, games that then took it from one character and one story and made it multiple characters with multiple different interlapping and overlapping storylines was kind of like groundbreaking. So just, yeah, playing with it.
So now the question. I do notice that, I do notice some presence of magical language in your theory. There is a little bit of alchemy, there is tarot, and I wonder, I think I sense some chaos magic in it. Can you, or maybe you would rather not to?
Maybe, because we have to keep this sort of element a little obscure.
That's
right?
What I was going to say.
Because the
don't
obscurity
do that.
Feeds into the weird mystical power of it. It's just like, I love talking with Karim about this because we'll never explicitly be like, yo, these are cosmic viral forces that are invading transcendentally to like reconfigure the material of the universe to the subjectivity of capital as a parallel to the subjectivity of Dasein, but right. I could get into it, you know what I'm saying? So it's
it's more so y'all too, because I'm like, yo, it's a chair, like, so
How does it? So it's definitely present. Yeah, please.
It's just the way I understand magic is it works within the mind. It's not any cosmic energy. That mm-hmm. is a mode of speaking. So it really becomes a way of diverting our attention to in certain directions without actually, and you just sort of seed it out there, and it grows and it follows its own path. So,
yeah.
I think it's a completely valid strategy.
And magic, both within like the historical discussions of like witchcraft and also the postmodern chaos magic thing, it's very structural. It deals a lot with institutions and how we believe in the myths that we create through patterns of behavior and how we might be able to change that. So it's effectively talking about like economic policy from a very different sort of angle, from a different dimension and way of talking about it. But you're weirdly trying to do the same goal. So we find that mixing the language is both fun to do and also super helpful to get people to think about the way that ground level behaviors and superstructures can interact with each other.
Yeah, I would have said the same.
This will be one of the last questions.
Okay.
Thank you for the presentation. And, oh, it's fine. And sorry if my, is it on? Okay. And sorry if the question is naive in advance, but it connects with magic. I've read the manifesto, and upon seeing your presentation, it's all very persuasive, very evocative, like just brilliant stuff, like aesthetically. But if you talk about universalism and basically global program, I mean, it feels like it works in some kind of group, but after reading the manifesto, even I had to Google the word tactology, for example. So where does the manifesto or the language and the evocativeness of your aesthetical project comes in the universalism? That is your goal, I guess.
Oh, okay. So how does the there's a bit of a distance between the manifesto that was posted and say like the theory of the firms, like, yeah. I mean, it's a work in progress. We're kind of starting at all these different nodes and then seeing where they intersect and where they overlap. Because we didn't talk about play at all.
No.
Before we showed each other our drafts. And yet it intersects and it overlaps in perfect ways. That's why we call it the hive mind. And that's why it's a work in progress. If your question is about feasibility, I think we've done a lot of work in simply identifying through the theory of political economics what needs to happen, right? Like a transcendence of masses, a movement from national to global. And the more policy goals are kind of forthcoming as we play with the language of this, right?
Well, also that we're a constellation of multiple different people, so you're kind of reading a lot of different voices at any given time. I think that we have, and we haven't released a lot of stuff also, so we're still working on it. But if you look at all the things that we have, and even these talks, everyone that we've done, and line it up together, you find multiple different languages and multiple different levels at which one can understand. I think personally that the manifesto is one of the more easier to read pieces for sure, and I think the companion as well. But that sometimes, I mean, you also do need some language that can accurately reflect the complexity of the issues that you're talking about. So it's mixing both of it that we kind of talked about,
Lil B is alt-woke, but also talking about technology. And it's not the worst that like people go look it up, because like maybe they'll get pulled into the fact that we talked about, you know, their favorite rapper or something. Yeah.
I mean, I believe that the formal language is a vehicle of the delivery, huh? It doesn't necessarily brings the whole package. It can bring the associative impulse. Huh? I think this is what you made also structurally. I have, it doesn't have to be the closing question, but
a
rather practical question, huh? What has art to do with it?
What has art to
art
do with
to
it?
Do with it?
Ooh.
Well, this is kind of art. We're trying to take a paper in economics or a paper in sociology and use really poetic and evocative language in bringing it out. And I think we cut off some rigor, but in the age of post-truth and in the age of hyper-reality and seeing the failures of leftism over the years and being hyper-rigorous and yet not getting anywhere, we're being bogged down in the technical discussions of Marxism and what exactly is like, you know, all of the terms and definitions. And I think that by using art as a vehicle and using theory as fiction weaponizes it in a more viral way. So the ideas are still there. They just have a more persuasive sort of vehicle.
I would also ask, I guess, do you mean capital A art, or are you talking about aesthetics?
I should leave this open, but I mean, when we are speaking about arts, we can speak about fields, territories, traffic. We can speak about form. We can speak about pedestal and object. We can speak about subjects. So this this spectra of possibilities with art on my mind. And also I really prefer to use this plural, you know? Because like, for example, in America, rapper is an artist. And very rarely in Europe, rapper is an artist, you know? So this, also there are like territorial specifics, like what it means. Like in Italy, you still call artist master, or in China, but you don't call artist master here, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Okay. Yeah, I think in a way, what Joe said is true. It's sort of what we're trying to do is inject a little bit of aestheticization to it, in that there's both the form of what we're saying, but typically there is a feeling that comes off of, or we've been told, our writing and our presentations that people get, sometimes negative, you know? And that is maybe like the more aesthetic qualities that we have. I don't know if I can purely be prescriptive to others in terms of the art that they should make, only in that maybe we could inspire.
So the ways in which things are shared right now are kind of all the same ways. Like we share memes, we share quotes, and these things have virality by the forms in which they are disseminated. And so you have to take theory and make it shareable, right? And so you have to conform to other things which are being shared, which are things like artworks and quotes and hot takes, you know, and think pieces. So everything is kind of converging because the methods by which we share things have also converged down to, you know, a society of images. Thank you so much for having us.
Oh,
yeah,
please.
Many
yeah.
thanks
Thank
to,
you so much.
To you. Many thanks.
Yeah. See you, buddy.